On November 4th, 1954, hundreds of military officials, reporters, and onlookers waited to witness the unveiling of the United States' latest radical aircraft. The strange-looking vehicle was the turbine-powered Convair XFY-1 Pogo, the world's first functioning vertical takeoff aircraft and high-speed fighter that needed no runway for takeoff or landing and promised to be the future protector of aircraft carriers. With experienced pilot James F. Coleman at the controls, the almost 15,000-pound aircraft bounced straight into the air and then switched to horizontal flight, circuiting the Californian airfield. The onlookers were certainly impressed, but little did they know the amount of difficulty it took to navigate the revolutionary aircraft. Protecting aircraft carriers. During World War II, aircraft carriers became an essential part of the U.S. Navy fleet, particularly in the Pacific Theater. Despite their success and reliability, wartime experiences revealed how vulnerable fixed land bases such as carriers' decks were against Axis attacks like Japanese kamikazes or underwater German U-boats. Following the detonation of a Soviet atomic bomb in 1949, Navy top brass became convinced that the country's air and sea assets were in more danger than ever. The Navy sought to expand the role and further protect surface warships, and soon began researching the feasibility of a vertical takeoff and landing aircraft, simply known as VTOL. In addition to VTOL capabilities, the Navy was also interested in a tail-sitting aircraft, capable of taking off while positioned vertically on its wings and tail surfaces, and then transitioning to traditional horizontal flight. A viable VTOL model could double the number of airframes a vessel could carry, as the aircraft would simply rise from the carrier and into the sky. Rather than occupying significant space like horizontal aircraft did, a tailsetter would take much less room, and it could be deployed from any vessel capable of handling a helicopter, such as fleet oilers, transports, and larger ships other than carriers. After conducting nearly 4 years of VTOL fighter studies, from 1948 to 1951, the U.S. Navy finally awarded contracts to both Convair and Lockheed to design and build flyable experimental VTOL aircraft. Although each contractor had agreed to build two prototypes, only one of each was finished, Lockheed's XFV-1 and Convair's XFY-1. When Lockheed's prototype failed to achieve a vertical takeoff and landing, mainly because the Navy only supplied the other competitor with a potent enough power plant, Convair was chosen as the winner. Pogo. For decades, vertical takeoff and landing was a dream for aviation designers. However, it proved a significant challenge to achieve and overcome, as an immense amount of power was required to lift the aircraft from the ground without the benefit or boost from wings. However, after World War II ended, more powerful engines became available, and the XFY-1 was one of the first to try them out. Also referred to as Pogo, the prototype experimental aircraft was unique and filled with exciting design features. With a short, stubby fuselage, two near-delta wings, and a pair of fins, one ventral and one dorsal, Pogo had a cruciform appearance. Its nickname came after Convair fitted a small wheel onto the end of a strut several feet long and mounted four of them to form an improvised landing gear at the tips of the wings and fins. These struts would then compress several feet, like a child's pogo stick, to soften the impact forces when landing. Pogo relied on a large Allison XT-40A turboprop engine consisting of two coupled T-38 machines that produced an estimated 6,500 shaft horsepower. Despite being a turboprop, a hybrid engine that provides jet thrust and drives a propeller, the Pogo came with a unique twist, a 16-foot contra-rotating three-bladed propeller, giving it the required thrust to hover off the ground and into the air. For vertical launch and landing, but horizontal cruising, the pilot seat could rotate for both safety and comfort. Convair also provided 25 feet of rope, strategically tied inside the cockpit if the pilot needed to dismount safely in case of off-field or emergency vertical landing. Although weapons were too far away in the development process, one proposed configuration consisted of up to four 20mm cannons mounted on the wingtips or 48 folding fin aerial rockets. Initial test. By February of 1954, Convair successfully tested the engine in a vertical stand, where it performed without problems, allowing the engineers to mount the airframe a month later. The project was subsequently moved to Naval Air Station Moffett Field to begin a series of tethered flight tests in the Bay Area. Then, on April 29th, Convair engineering test pilot and lieutenant colonel in the Marine Reserves, James F. Skeets Coleman, performed the prototype's first tethered flight inside the hangar that once housed the iconic USS Macon dirigible craft. The pressure was on for Coleman, as Pogo was unlike any other propeller-driven aircraft before it, and no previous prototype with a similar weight, engine power, or size had ever attempted a vertical takeoff and landing. For safety, Convair removed the propeller hub cover, replacing it with safety tether lines in case Coleman lost control of the Pogo and needed to be tethered to prevent a crash landing. Meanwhile, on the other side of the tether, engineer Bob McGeary controlled the winch that would be used to raise the ropes and prevent the Pogo from rapidly plummeting to the ground. And the engineers also fastened 4 security cables to each wing for further precaution, given the potentially dangerous nature of the experimental aircraft. Presenting it to the world. Over the course of a month, Coleman logged close to 60 hours of tethered Pogo test flights, not without plenty of eventualities. During the tests, 16-foot diameter propellers would thrash up powerful airflow that caused the XFY-1 to become highly turbulent as the aircraft washed against the inside of the hangar. This sudden increase of airflow led to a few instances wherein McGeary received instructions from Coleman to spin the reel and tighten the tether to steady the teetering Pogo while desperately screaming and pleading to be caught. By the summer of 1954, the tests moved outdoors, and Coleman completed his first 3 free and untethered flights in a single day on August 1st, rising 150 feet into the air on the second try. Eventually, Convair moved the Pogo to another air station to complete more tests, including the transition from vertical to horizontal flight. Coleman exceeded expectations during these additional 70 flights, gaining valuable data and experience with each trial. Then, on November 2nd, Coleman and Convair made history by completing the first vertical takeoff of a fixed-wing aircraft in the United States, followed by a transition to horizontal flight and a successful landing in vertical mode. With this feat, Convair and the Navy decided it was time for the Pogo to make a public debut, showing off the world's first vertical takeoff aircraft 2 days later. During the event, Coleman bounced the Pogo in the air in vertical mode and hurtled away in horizontal flight at 200 feet. Several hundred Navy and Convair top officials and news reporters watched as Coleman bounced the XFY-1 into the air straight up, and the delta-winged ship circuited the field during a 23-minute demonstration. Major setbacks. Despite meeting all Navy specifications, including being able to take off vertically and rest on its tail, Pogo has several shortcomings. During landing operations, the pilot had no choice but to lean over his shoulder, similar to parallel parking a car. This maneuver meant that the aircraft required a pilot with a high degree of abilities and experience. As such, it became pretty evident that the VTOL aircraft would only be flown by senior pilots, and it would be impossible to place a large quantity of them in every Navy ship. Coleman climbed the Pogo for the last time on February 5, 1955, and for months, Pogo remained abandoned in the hangar until a less experienced pilot attempted to fly it without tethers and almost lost his life in the process. Although another set of pilots began to train with the aircraft in May of 1956, the end was near for the XFY-1, as its gearbox was starting to show signs of wear and rust. Additionally, another insurmountable issue with the Pogo project was its engine. Although turboprop-engined aircraft dominated the skies during World War II, jet technology quickly outclassed those models in the 1950s. Whereas these new models had top speeds that matched or surpassed the speed of sound, the turboprop tailsitter could only fly as fast as 580 miles per hour, not enough speed to assure survival in case of actual conflict where the enemy possessed jet air power. By then, the US Navy was interested in other projects and doctrines of air superiority, which led to the introduction of jet aircraft such as the iconic Grumman F-9F Cougar and the Douglas A-4 Skyhawk, resulting in the definite cancellation of the XFY-1 Pogo program. Ultimately, the aircraft proved that the VTOL and the tail-sitting concept were theoretically possible, but plenty of work was required to turn the idea into operational success. The only flight-worthy Pogo prototype ever produced remained in hangars for decades, until it was sent to the National Air and Space Museum in 1973, where one of the most strange-looking Navy aircraft remains to this day. Thank you for watching our Dark Skies video. Let us know your thoughts about this revolutionary aircraft in the comment section below, and make sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell to get more exciting historical content. Stay tuned.